Good evening. Today is the 24th day of October, 2016, and we continue with our explorations in Savitri with our brother Alok. Namaskar. We ended on page 154 of Book 2, the Book of the Travel Around the Worlds, Canto 5, The Godheads of the Little Life. And I wanted to say something about the breaks that Sri Aurobindo gives us. For me, they're extremely important because we must pause before we begin the next section. And we pause to reflect back or absorb ourselves in what we have just read. And then we can move on. And in this case, we're going to move on to this extraordinary view of creation.
Absolutely.
So before we begin, I'd like to just complete the mother's words on the last passage. And she says, it's explained very well in Savitri. All these things have their laws and their conventions. And truly speaking, a really formidable power is needed to change anything of their rights. For they have rights, what they call laws. It's the law, and who has the right to change the law? Death says. And then comes this wonderful passage at the end where she replies, my God can change it. And my God is a God of love. Oh, how magnificent. And by force of repeating this to him, he yields. She replies in this way to everything.
He's death.
He is death, yes.
Death yields.
My God is a God of love. So, we begin the next section.
Yes, but as you said, we just read the last four lines or five lines because, you know, it's worth remembering because we try and struggle with life, with all the issues, with all the problems, with all the difficulties and challenges. We debate and discuss on every possible television, national and otherwise. But what really ties us to our doom, and here doom is not just an individual or national doom. See, civilizations have existed which have plunged into entire darkness. Mother speaks about it.
Oh, yeah.
And we use the word so lightly, pralaya, oh, six times pralaya has taken place. Just imagine, you know, the other day I was, look at Baghdad. Today, you know, look at today's Baghdad and the area around. What a darkness. But look at Baghdad way back when it was at one time the hub of, you know, cultural center in the, you know, bygone days, where even the caliph there had one of the largest libraries which contains books like the Upanishads. They had their own Vedic, near Vedic culture in Persia, for instance. Ahur Mazda, this entire thing was Vedic culture,
yes.
Worship of the fire, and what a magnificent civilization, what art and culture. And today, when you look at it, it's a collapse. Same thing you see in India at one point of time. What a mighty civilization. You know, people had, you know, arrows which could be connected with the highest states of consciousness, weaponry of that kind. Through the mantras, they could heal, they could fly, they could do things which, if today people will think it's myth, unimaginable. But I do believe they knew they had the occult capacities. But you see, 100 years back or even 50 years back, as Shubindo says in Durga Strot, India lies low, prone, full of tamas, inertia. So it's miserable. It shouldn't happen. And yet, to change it, we must know what is the cause, how this creation is built. And first we have the remedy, the prescription, the grand prescription. Shubindo, as the divine doctor, is writing a prescription for us. This is our doom until our souls are free. Whatever other remedies will be, will always be palliatives. A mighty hand then rolls mind's firmaments back. Infinity takes up the finite's acts. When the souls are freed, then this happens. And nature steps into the eternal light. Then only ends this dream of nether life. We are not living a reality. We believe we are living a reality. But we are really living a bad dream. Sometimes there are good moments in bad dreams. But at the end of the day, as long as there is death, as long as there is old age, as long as there is depravity and disintegration, you can't call it a good dream. It's a bad dream, all said and done. So now he sets on to explain to us how all this came into being. As you said, it's an extraordinary passage. Several places we see Sri Aurobindo again and again going back to the origin of creation, right? Yes. In Book 1, Canto 1, several places. From every point. And the reason is, any finite point in this universe, any separate, seemingly separate unit of life, any movement, you touch and go deep, it's like a key, you will discover the origin. So now, why this little life has come into being, he's explaining to us, but from a top-down view.
Yes.
So here he starts with the origin. After a long, long passage, he will reveal to us why it is there, the way it is there.
Yeah.
So that means to explain anything, we must understand everything. And as long as we don't know the whole, we cannot understand the part. At the outset of this enigmatic world, it is an enigma, no doubt about it. Anyone who tries to oversimplify the world and its mechanisms, separates it into neat black and white, is just fooling oneself. Which seems at once an enormous brute machine and a slow unmasking of the spirit in things simultaneously. So it's an enigma. If you look from this side, it looks like a brute machine. That's how the physical scientists will tell us. Unintelligibly. What is meaningful about it? Nothing makes sense. There are people who say that, you know, it's we who put sense into it. There is no sense in this world. But if you look at it from another side, you see something else. You see the slow unmasking of the spirit in things. So it depends on the vantage point. And now, look at the image in this revolving chamber without walls. You see, you revolve on this side, you have one vision. You go to the other side, you have another vision. And yet, the beauty is, in this revolving chamber without walls, in which God sits impassive everywhere, as if unknown to himself and by us unseen, in a miracle of inconscient secrecy, yet is all here, his action and his will. In a miracle of inconscient secrecy. There are two original miracles. How the supreme, omnipotent, omniscient became the darkest shadow, helpless, weak, inert. And the other miracle is how this changes into that. So that's why before we talk about the mystery of death, we must understand the mystery of birth, the birth of creation itself. And this reminds me of an Upanishadic line, yet is all here, his action and his will. There is an Upanishad, Kathopanishad, where Yama reveals the secret of life and death and immortal life to Nachiketa, a young aspirant. And in one of the very inspired verses, it's a series of verses, he says, Suryo yatha sarva lokasya chakshu, nalipyate chakshushe bahya dosha, eko vashi sarva bhutantaratma, nalipyate loka dukhe nabahya. So he says that just as the sun shines in the highest firmaments, Surya looks upon all things equally, the criminal draws the light and life from the sun and does a crime. The sage draws the life and light from the sun and evolves into whatever. So he is impassive. You know, we heard the impassive. Suryo yatha sarva lokasya chakshu. Nalipyate chakshushe bayadosha. It does not bind itself to anything. It's not, you can't say the sun is the criminal because it gave life to the criminal. So it is impassive. And yet, without the sun, there would be no life, no creation, nothing. We owe it to the sun as much as we owe it to the earth. So he is impassive everywhere, yet everything is the secret action of his will. And now Shobindu will explain to us how. Of course, something very obvious, we see it, but we refuse to acknowledge it. But before that, a very fundamental truth. In this whirl and sprawl through infinite vacancy, the spirit became matter and lay in the whirl, a body sleeping without sense or soul. So it is not that there is spirit and there is matter. After all, there is only one. So anything else has to emerge from the one. So the spirit becomes matter by a process of progressive condensation or self-limitation. To give an analogy with all its limitations. Vapor which ascends high has the same basic thing as ice, which, you know, solidly stays below. They have very different consistencies, very different movements. And yet they are the same thing. You condense and concentrate vapor, it becomes ice. Ice has its own purposes. Vapor has its own. Vapor can make a balloon fly. Ice cannot. Ice will make it sink. And yet it is that which has become this. So that's the beauty of creation. So it is the spirit that has become matter, and therefore matter can become spirit. That is why in Shurbindo's basic metaphysical thought, we cannot neglect or ignore matter. We have to reclaim matter's divinity. But that is the challenge, to reclaim matter's divinity. A mass phenomenon of visible shapes, supported by the silence of the void, appeared in the eternal consciousness and seemed an outward and insensible world. Look at this, another marvelous line. Appeared in, all around. You know, in the Vedas, there is an image that Diti, the mother of division and darkness, is surrounded by Aditi, who, as the name suggests, Aditi, is infinite consciousness. Also comes from the root Ad and Iti. So it is infinite consciousness, undivided consciousness, that surrounds the finite. So we see the same, you know, suggestion here, that it is in the eternal, though it appears as if it is outside. So it looks as if it is outside, that God is somewhere else in some heaven, and this is outside, but it is also held within him.
And Sri Aurobindo uses seems in the
seem
second, and then seemed. Seems first, then seemed.
Yes. So this is to our vision. There was none there to see and none to feel. Only the miraculous inconscient. It's like a magician's hat. Everything comes out of it. It's a miraculous inconscient. A subtle wizard skilled was at its task. The inconscient, because it holds within itself the superconscient. And therefore it, you know, all magicians who do impossible things taking out from the hat, everybody knows it's there inside, but we don't see it. It doesn't know, we don't know how, but there is a way that it's there. It's an illusion, it's a trick. So everything is there suppressed in the inconscient, and therefore it is bound to emerge. And that is where we have hope. If God was elsewhere, we can doubt. But if he has become creation, he is within creation, he holds the creation within himself, then any which way you go, there is hope.
And in the worm foresees the
coming God. Thou who disdainest not the worm to be, nor even the clod. Therefore we know by that humility that thou art God. He can become this matter. And we want to always remain holy saints. So inventing ways for magical results. See, this creation is really magic. If simple thing like, why does hydrogen and oxygen combine to create what we experience as water is a magic. There is no clear answer to this question by any scientist anywhere in the world.
And no one has defined electricity.
No one has defined it. That's true. Why is it that simultaneously things appear as wave as well as particle? Even light. So no one knows, you know, how electrical charges become solid objects. Everything is a magic. That's why at one place Savitri says to this fellow, Mr. Death, not a good fellow by any means. Mother says it's human beings who have made him a god. In the consciousness of human beings, because human beings think anybody who is powerful is god. They have made him god. So she says, all's miracle here and can by miracle change. It is a miracle how this becomes solid. So, inventing ways, managing creation's marvelous device, marking mechanically dumb wisdom's points. Look at it. You know, dumb wisdom. A child is born. The most fundamental necessities which on which his survival depends are not taught by any teacher or parent. It knows when it feels hungry. It suckles, it digests, it breathes, its heart beats. Marvelous device. Imagine if parents and teachers had to teach all this. But parents and teachers always live in an illusion that they are going to, you know, make the child into something.
Mother says that we can only help to bring out what is already in the soul.
Nature does most in him, God the high rest.
Yes.
Only his soul's consent is his own. Man is a dynamo for God's work. Savitri.
Yeah.
So we have to just align ourselves, refer back again and again the finite to the infinite. That's the best we can do. And of course, as long as we live in the illusion, we carry on. Using the unthought, inevitable idea. It's not that, you know, people say, why did God make this world like this? So sometimes I ask, okay, supposing you had to make it, what you would make? You will plan this, plan that. So with all the mental intelligence, we have created a world which is already on the verge of a mess. This is how mental intelligence operates. For every solution, it creates fresh problems. Today I was sharing with my friend that look at, you know, medicine. Marvelous, wonderful things. Today you can replace knee, God knows tomorrow they'll replace heart and brain and everything. But look at it. I was sharing with him 40 years back when I was a child in my village. Even after graduating medicine, we had just two or three antibiotics, sulfadiazine, lidocaine, and ampicillin had just come in the market. And we were so thrilled with it. Ampicillin was used for VIPs. And people got all right. We didn't get a bad spot on our career because of using these basic medicines. There was no knee replacement or knee surgery. Our parents lived up to old age, managing everything. Now we have all these things, but we have more hospitals, more diseases, more medicines, more poor immunity, more.
And when Mother put Nirbhendra in charge, the children would come to him and he would listen, sit quietly, smile at them, and they would pour out their hearts on all that was hurting them. And at the end, he'd say, you want the red pill or the green?
We grew up on pink mixture and green one mixture. There was no other mixture. And if you know what was in the mixture, you'll be horrified. It contained APC, aspirin, paracetamol, and what was C? Caffeine. So it worked on pain, it worked on fever, it worked on sore throat, it worked on nasal blockage, everything in the world. APC, that was very big. Oh, he has given APC. So it was like, not Alok Pandey C. But see, it worked. But now, you know, you have big prescriptions and it doesn't work. You have complications, you have resistant infections, you have huge hospitals. And even here, we have now knee replacement is the in thing. Yeah. So... So inevitable, because it's not by thought, it's by the inevitable idea. This is nothing else but the imperative supramental truth. This idea is in its highest sense. It's there in it. Look at how a seed blossoms into a exactly the same tree of which it is. We use the word genes so casually, but look at what drives these genes and builds an oak tree out of an oak seed. It won't be a mango. Try how much ever you do prayer, homam, yagna, mantras, anything. It will grow into that. How does it happen? It's an inevitable idea which pushes everything like a chessboard towards that. And it's not thought out. It did the works of God's intelligence. If you look at creation, it looks like it is really perfectly, this world is marvelous intelligence behind every smallest activity. And that is the beauty of creation. So if you look at it deep inside, we will see on the surface inconscient mechanical nature. But behind we'll see a wisdom and an intelligence operating. And that fills us with faith and trust and hope that, well, if it has carried the journey up to man, it will carry him beyond man. Or wrought the will of some supreme unknown. Still, consciousness was hidden in nature's womb. Unfelt was the bliss whose rapture dreamed the worlds. So this first matter is born. Matter itself is a marvel, a miracle. But consciousness is still inside, hidden inside.
And the bliss is unfelt.
Bliss is unfelt. It has changed into bliss into black coma fallen. So it is comatose. It's in a state of inertia. Shiva lying, on whose breast Kali is dancing. Unfelt was the bliss whose rapture dreamed the worlds. What a hope. Who built the worlds? Not some cheat of Maya. Bliss has built the worlds. So it must be there everywhere. And our goal is bliss. Our final inevitable destiny is bliss. Being was an inert substance driven by force. This is the image of Shiva turning into inert. And Kali, blind force, trampling over everything in creation. So that's the image of being becoming inert substance. Its huge vibrations at first was only an etheric space. Just an extension of Brahman. Extends himself as space. And then Brahman moves and it becomes time. So first is a self-extension. But in that self-extension, there is a first vibration. So you see its beauty. How is the space created? Take a still pond and put a stone in it. So what happens? You will see ripples. Now, you know, through the ripples, it becomes visible to you. It goes to a point, and though in a pond or a lake you cannot see it, but these waves will go and hit back and come back. Now when they come back, there are waves which are going from this side, waves coming from the other side, and they will collide. And when they collide, some miniature forms, there would be turbulence, there would be eddy, like a mini form there. This is exactly how creation takes place. So there is an etheric space in which there is a vibration, which is beautiful, harmonious vibration. It will push the space a little and come back from there. Go back and push the space a little more and come back. Go back, push the space a little more. So that's how space is constantly expanding. And they say today, the latest count, any which side we look, you will have 10 lakhs galaxies in front of you. Galaxies, not stars. Can we imagine? Any which way, any small degree you turn, you will have 200 billion galaxies whirling in space and expanding. So it's a mighty vibration. And that vibration goes, pushes, and as it comes back, it hits the... So there is a first stir of form. So that he will explain beautifully. Its huge vibrations circle round and round, housing some unconceived initiative, upheld by a supreme original breath. How he describes, see, universe expands and contracts. It is breathing.
Yes.
It is living. It's conscious. It is born. It dies. Everything. Only one breath of the universe means right now it is still inhaling. It's going on expanding. Expansion and contractions, mystic act, created touch and friction in the void. This is what I was just sharing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Expansion and contraction. So, it creates touch. What is touching? The same, but in two opposite directions. So, it creates the sense of otherness, touch and friction. What an original, you know, physics it is. Parent of an expanding universe. Now these marvelous lines. In a matrix of disintegrating force, by spending, it conserved an endless sum. That's see, it's
fascinating
line. Everywhere we see it. You know, you spend money and you buy gold. Nowadays, old time, gold. So you have spent. The money is gone. But you have something which is conserved. The value is conserved. So energy disintegrates. Matter is born. Energy is withheld inside, conserved. Parents give birth to a child. They have expended their energy and they will go on expending their energy for the rest of their lives. But they have conserved themselves, extended themselves in their progeny. So you see what a beautiful line it applies right from there. Energy and matter. Here he is speaking of energy and matter in a matrix of disintegrating force. You know, the vibration in the etheric space, it becomes lesser and lesser. If you see these vibrations are most forceful at the center, then they will become lesser and lesser. It's a disintegrating force. By spending, it conserved an endless sum. Matter and energy are the same. I mean, they are two sides of one reality. It can turn into this or that can turn. But here it is now conserved. It is held back as a potential. This image is amazing. On the hearth of space, it kindled a viewless fire. Now space has come. The aerial principle has come. Now comes the fire. So the first yajna is all this Brahmand is lit up with a fire. You know, there is a story which I share sometimes of Guru Nanak. So, it's a pity that now if you go to Jagannath temple, you see that, you know, people are not, some certain castes are not allowed inside. I think foreigners are also not allowed inside. It's a pity. I'm sure it must have come later on, or maybe at some point of time when things were, so untouchables not allowed. So, once Guru Nanak was going and along with him was a person from a lesser caste. Of course, caste has a very different meaning from the original point of view. So we should, what we see today is not the truth. So they stopped, they said, you can go, but not him. So he said, no, how can I go without him? So he stayed outside. He didn't enter the Jagannath temple. But then as he looks into the starlit sky, he sees the Jagannath and the stars as the Arati. So he writes a beautiful line, couplet, whole prayer. Gagan mandal me thal birajat. This whole sky has become the plate and stars are lit like flames for thy oblation and prayer, O unseen Lord. He is the Jagannath, Lord of the universe. So he is the original Lord of the universe.
And that image of the hearth of space.
Yes, hearth of space. The fire is lit, invisible fire. And that fire burns in everyone. It burns in earth. In everyone, in every atom. Mother has one of the prayers where she says, hidden in the heart of each atom, I kindle therein the fire that never dies out. She is the one who has kindled. Here it's not revealed to us.
Yes.
But kindle, the fire is kindled. This is the yajna. That scattering worlds as one might scatter seeds, whirled out the luminous order of the stars. So what does this fire do now? Scatters the seeds into space. This is the fluid principle. It just throws itself out. The vital force.
Yeah.
seeds are scattered into space. They are stars, original seeds, the lamps of God, an ocean of electric energy. Formlessly formed its strange wave particles. This is Sri Aurobindo. Let's not forget 1947, 48, when very little was known about the... Yes, it was already known, but he didn't have that kind of an access or that kind of a, you know, somebody to tell us like today on television. And he knew fully the wave particle duality. Wave particle. You look at it, it's wave. You look at it, particle. Mother speaks about true matter. She says, this is not the true matter. This bumps against everything. This is like particles. Whereas you have another matter which is very fluid. She speaks of that. She says, it can become round. Yeah. It can, you know, it doesn't touch an edge. She's actually describing the supramental body. Yeah. She says, when it comes to an edge, it just moves around. But this body, this will go and hit. She says, she's living two experiences simultaneously. She says, I have that other experience where it just goes around. But this feet, why does it bump? Yeah. Wave particle. So look at from one point and another. This is the miracle. Constructing by their dance this solid scheme. This is the dance, the original dance. You know? Its mightiness in the atom shut to rest. Now imagine what that power is that makes all this energy concealed in an atom. You blow it, it can blow a whole world. Shuts in an atom. Masses were forced or feigned. Look at this. Forced. You can say it was made of feigned because it is not as it appears to us. There is something which our senses add to it. The real shapes are very different from how we perceive or every creature perceives because senses add to it. So that's why there is forced, created, built, forced as in a smithy, but also feigned. We add something to it. And visible shapes, light flung the photons, swift revealing sparks. So just as we have atoms as the unit of, or electron as the unit of matter, light is different from matter. It doesn't behave like matter. For instance, gravity and all. There are modern theories, they are talking about that. But the basic unit of life, light is photon. So light also behaves like as if particle or as a waveform. So photons flash. And showed in the minuteness of its flash, imaged the cosmos of apparent things. So this creation is a marvel. Thus has been made this real impossible world. How could it be?
How beautiful. Huh?
How can energy become matter? How can the formless become form? You know, when people often say, it's impossible for God to take human birth. So there are many arguments. This is a very old argument, you know, like some of the, even in India, there are people who don't believe in avatarhood. But they say divine cannot become limited. He is formless. But the point is that if you go back to the original thought, the formless has become form. It's the first act already performed. Of course, avatar is a very special sense and we don't go into it. But the issue is that this itself is strange. Impossible world. How could it be? How can electric energies become solid substance? I used to be vexed with this question. During medical college, one day I got into this question and for days I was wondering how this has become. And I was asked, one of my friends, we would go out and discuss and we would try to get into physics and explain it. But it's impossible. All your experiences, it is solid and physics says it is not solid.
Yeah.
It's electrons, protons, neutrons in empty space. How much empty space? 99.9% is empty space. 0.1% is electron, proton, neutron. What are electron, proton, neutron? Charges, energies, electrical energy. So that is experienced as solid mass. Not only solid mass, varied objects. I can understand if one particular mass varied objects from the same principle technique. What a wizardry. It's like somebody with the same thread has created colors, designs, patterns, garments, everything possible. From the body tissue to the rock, it's the same basic thing, atoms. So you look at this real, impossible world. It's real in every which way, and yet it's impossible. An obvious miracle or convincing show.
And there's the humor.
Lot of humor in Savitri. Actually, we can take a whole book on humor in Savitri.
Yes.
And this is a bit of, you know, reply to many that, look, you know, who speak of it as purely mechanical with nothing inside. Well, then there are only two conclusions. Either it has somehow happened, an obvious miracle, or it's a convincing show. Somebody has put up a show which is too good and too, you know, we just believe it, we can't help it. Or so it seems to man's audacious mind. So here comes the catch. Who sets his thought as the arbiter of truth, his personal vision as impersonal fact. So here Sri Aurobindo demolishes the entire material scientist argument based on his so-called facts. He says, if these are the facts, then it's either a miracle or a show. If what you say alone is true, if there is no consciousness, if there is no being, as witness of an objective world, his erring sense and his instruments artifice. So here comes that role which senses play. It is senses that weave things into the kind of experience that we have of them. Even of the most material object, there are senses corresponding to that. Now this sense is something very different, right, from the supramental. So there is an original vision of things in the supramental senses. And they come down and down and down till they become these gross senses. Thus must he work life's tangible riddle out in a doubtful light by error seize on truth. So we should not be afraid of error. At one place, mother says, because one is afraid of making mistakes, one doesn't do anything. She says that you know, people who are seeking after nirvana. Error is an approximation. That's how you come near to truth. You don't seize it by two hands suddenly.
Our errors are his steps
upon the way. Yes, the one who has made this world is ever its Lord.
Yes.
Our errors are his steps upon the way. He works through the fierce vicissitudes of our toils. He works through the hard breath of battle and toil. He works through our sorrows, our sins, and our tears. Whatever the appearance we must bear, when nothing we can see but drift and bail, a mighty guidance leads us still through all. Okay, this is the original Vedanta. What is error? We are so afraid, so much mortal. It's an attempt to find something. When you don't find it, you say it was a mistake. So people give up finding. You know, there are people who, I mean, a few days back, just in one of the counseling sessions, someone says, oh, all human beings are bad. Love is nonsense. This, I said, why are you drawing such fantastic conclusions? Because in one experience, you taste something which is not right or bad. That's how you grow till you are ready for that glory of glories. So error in everything. See, the worldview 100 years back. In 1900, there was a science congress. So all the scientists of the world, Lord Kelvin, he was the great one that time, the president of the World Science Congress. He's the famous, you know, absolute zero, that Kelvin scale. So he declared, now we have found everything. Only there are two things we need to know, and that was the photoelectric effect, the black body radiation, and the movement of the stars. He said, we'll soon find it. We have discovered everything, and we will discover it, and we will know everything about everything. That same year, God has a sense of humor. Both these things were discovered by Max Planck and Einstein. That changed the whole previous knowledge. That became dated. The entire world of solid physics became dated with these two discoveries because it gave a new understanding to everything. Now again, we have a theory of everything. God knows 10, 20 years down the line what's going to happen. Man, somehow, you know, if audacious
people,
mind.
If people haven't seen The Man Who Knew Infinity,
yes,
they should see it.
Yes, huh? Yes, yes. That's a lovely.
And they say that in Oxford, they found a recent diagram of his.
This just for people's reference. It's about Ramanujam.
Yes.
Am I right? Yeah. Yes. It's a story. And it's the life of C. Ramanujam, the mathematical genius.
Yeah. And that explains the black holes.
Yes. And just for information, his mother had asked for him from the local goddess whom she used to connect as Saraswati, but like, you know, and it was a boon from her. And this man could not bear the honors of this goddess. Actually, he lived like a saint.
Yeah.
Even though married, hardly anything, and then he died very young.
Very young.
He didn't care for riches, he didn't care for success. His story is amazing, as you said. It's a must-watch film. We are not doing any advertisement, by the way. People shouldn't mistake that we are promoting a movie and getting any. But it's a worth watch. The Man Who Knew Infinity. So it's, you know, by errors he's. And slowly part the visage and the veil, step by step.
Beautiful.
You know, mother speaks of it that, you know, why are illusions given? She said, and this is there in the Ish Upanishad, that the path to the infinite is not by breaking the finite, but by enlarging it. So it will reach a limit, hold, then it will break and you'll see another boundary. Then break, you'll see another boundary. So enlarge it. Don't just break it and escape into it like the Zen Buddhists. Because that's not the path. The path carved out of old. Kurvanne vihe karmani jiji vishe chatang sama. Through works. Or else, we have a few more lines which will, you know, complete this movement. Or else, forlorn of faith in mind and sense, his knowledge a bright body of ignorance. He sees in all things strangely fashioned here the unwelcome jest of a deceiving force, a parable of Maya and her might. So if you don't take that approach where you look deeper and understand the ways of divine in the world and see that each illusion is given us to step one more step forward, like that famous story of, I think it is Bhrigu and his son, Varuni. So he says that, what is the ultimate truth, Brahman? He says, meditate and find. So he meditates and comes back. Shubhendu quotes this story in The Human Cycle and elsewhere also. So he says, I have discovered Father and Guru. I have discovered matter is Brahman. So he doesn't say no. He says, very good. Meditate further. He comes back and says, matter is moved by life, is there in it. Life is Brahman. Annam Brahmeti, then, you know, Pranam Brahmeti. He says, very good. Meditate further. Now he says, oh. So he doesn't deny. So he goes and says that it is the thought which is Brahman. Mind is Brahman. He says, good, you are progressing. Very good. You're right. But go one more step further. So he discovers the causal idea. Vijnanam, the supramental. So he says, you have just gone very far, but take one more step. And then he goes further and says, now I see beyond cause and effect, Anandam Brahmeti. All this is Ananda, expression of Ananda, the manifold waves of Ananda. Nothing else is there but Ananda playing with itself. But if we don't have that vision, it appears a cruel play done by somebody who has bad sense of humor in jest to deceive people.
Deceiving force.
Deceiving force. Which, you know, and it's bad. You know, like sometimes children do it in a jest. They just put a, you know, feet in front of somebody who is walking and the person trips over. They are laughing, but the other fellow is hurt. But if you know the play, you know that, you know, this fellow will do it, and you beat him on the play or jump over, then you have the laugh that, look, you know, I fooled you. So this is the play. It is a play of the divine ananda from one point of view. From another point of view, oh, who has cheated us? Who has confined us? Who has imprisoned us? And then we end up saying a parable of Maya and her might. No deceiving Maya this is. It is the wonderful Leela of the divine. So we'll stop here.